Radio Theatre.
In the air.
Dedicated to man's imagination, the theater of the mind.
You know what our call letters WGN stand for, don't you?
Welcome to WGN Radio Theater.
A special three-hour presentation.
And your hosts, Carl Amari and Lisa Wolf.
All right, it's 10 minutes after 10 p.m. here on the WGN Radio Theater, world's greatest newspaper, Lisa. The vivacious one herself right next to me. How you doing, Lisa?
Hi, Carl. Glad to be here. It's a big Saturday night.
It is. We have Shante Garth, our producer, in the booth. And we have five classic radio shows all the way to 3 o'clock in the morning.
And we have a full five-hour show tonight, yeah. So we're really excited about that.
Yep, we're going to start things off with You Bet Your Life. Our listeners have been clamoring for more Groucho Marx. So we have a Groucho Marx episode for you from 1955. After that, a true crime case on Whitehall, 1212 from 1952. Then we have The Lives of Harry Lime. Orson Welles stars as Harry Lime from 1951. Then Robert Young stars as Jim Anderson, Father Knows Best from 1950. And then we'll wrap things up with a Gunsmoke episode from 1956 starring William Conrad.
Right. And before that, we usually have our little segment, which used to be Guess That Song. We've decided to move on from Guess That Song.
We're retiring it. Should we have taps? Should we play taps for it?
Yeah, that's okay. That's okay. Because we're on to bigger and better here. I guess you're going to do what you want. Our new segment.
Once I get going, it's hard to stop me.
Our new segment is called Just the Facts.
Yeah.
You'll learn a little bit more about it. It's going to be some fun facts, trivia, and history from the year of the radio show that we will be playing in that hour.
Okay.
So we can look forward to a little background.
And we haven't rehearsed this. I don't know what she's going to be talking about.
Not
We're just going to have some fun with it. And all that begins right after these words.
Ladies and gentlemen, the story you're about to hear is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
This is our new Just the Facts segment. I hope you all recognize that theme song.
Yeah, I've heard it once or
Carl,
twice.
Once or twice, pretty much here on this radio show from Dragnet. And we are going to be talking about 1955, which is the radio show we'll be playing in hour one, You Bet Your Life. So first of all, the best, happiest, most magical place on earth opened July 17th, 1955.
Disneyland. What? Has
Disneyland.
To be Disneyland.
It is Disneyland. Let's hear that.
Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams.
This is Walt Disney speaking.
That have created America with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world.
I can tell you that Mike Estella did not digitally remaster that clip.
Absolutely not. But this was actually recorded in 1955 by Walt Disney himself.
Wow.
And what a thing he did to pave the way for more magic.
The guy was a genius.
He sure
was. And his head is frozen, I think, right now.
that's probably.
Cryogenically frozen.
I think that's true. Also, now in 1955, we had the first large home microwave oven. That's when actually they started going into people's homes. It was invented in 45. That's when the patent was actually filed. But Tappan introduced a large 220 They were all Tappan. And that's what we did. You have a microwave oven growing up?
I think as a kid we had a microwave oven. I think
you don't remember.
Well, I mean, not when I was real young. So probably around. I would guess we got our first microwave oven
probably in the 60s.
Like, I was going to say late 60s.
I kind of remember getting them when we got it. It was sort of a big deal to have it.
Oh, yeah.
And at this point, who doesn't have a microwave?
Everyone has a microwave.
Well, I don't know about that.
I mean, pretty much every household.
I think so, but maybe we would be surprised.
Yeah.
And other than that, Rosa Parks, this was 1955, refused to give up her bus seat. This was in Montgomery, Alabama, December 1st of 55.
Wow.
And of course, this event was a catalyst for the civil rights movement in the United States.
Wow. Okay. Great stuff. 1955.
Great
it was the same year that You Bet Your Life was broadcast, and we have a You Bet Your Life episode for you right now. But first, I want to remind all of our listeners about our website that has five free classic radio shows waiting for you. Now, when you go to 100radioshows.com. So 100radioshows.com. You go to the top of the website, you just put your email in, and you will be sent 5 classic radio shows digitally remastered as a thank you for listening to this show. You'll get Suspense with Gregory Peck, Jack Benny, you'll get Richard Diamond, Private Detective, Gunsmoke, and Fibber McGee and Molly. 5 shows, full-length shows, digitally remastered by Mike, sent to you instantly. As soon as you put your email in and hit send, you'll get it within like a minute. I was with Dave Plyer the other day, and he did it, and he had them like instantly.
He did it while you were talking
Yeah,
with
we were
him?
Talking, and yeah. we had dinner, and he did it, and boom, he had it.
Boom, right to your email.
He was like, wow, I already have
magic.
Now, at that same website, there are 7 collections that have 100 radio shows in each one of those collections. And if you use the promo code radio at checkout, you will save 70% off the regular price. So our listeners get not only 5 free shows, but they save 70% on anything they want to buy. But make sure you use the promo code radio at checkout. All right, You Bet Your Life was a game show hosted by the great Groucho Marx of the Marx Brothers fame. And the assistant and announcer on the show was George Fenneman. It began on ABC Radio way back in 1947. It made a transition to television in 1950, but for many years it overlapped. It was on radio and TV. Each show offered a secret word like house, money, hat, etc., and contestants would banter about their life with Groucho, and if by chance they said the secret word, well, they'd get $100. Not bad.
I love right? the concept.
Get $100. And then they'd also win money for answering questions put to them by Groucho at the end of the show. And oftentimes, there were celebrity contestants, too. You Bet Your Life enjoyed a long run, bowing out in 1961. So from 47 to 61, You Bet Your Life. So the secret word on this particular episode is clock. Groucho Marx, George Fenneman, January 31st, 1955. Uninterrupted, here is You Bet Your Life.
Ladies and gentlemen, the secret word tonight is clock. C-L-O-C-K.
Really?
You Bet Your Life. The more than 3,000 DeSoto Plymouth dealers of America present Groucho Marx in You'll Bet Your Life, the comedy quiz series produced and transcribed from Hollywood. And here he is, the one, the only...
Groucho! That's me, Groucho Marx. Well, here I am again with $1,000 for one of our couples. Fenneman, who's first to try for it?
Well, Groucho, just before we went on the air, our studio audience selected a clerk from the unemployment office, Mrs. Louise Ludwig, and her partner, Mrs. Marjorie Kendall, was selected because of her unusual occupation. And here they are. Ladies, come right up here and meet Groucho Marx.
Well, welcome, kids, for the DeSoto Plymouth dealers. And if you say the secret word and divide $100, it's a common word, something you see every day. Mrs. Louise Ludwig? That's you. Where are you from, Louise?
I'm from Honolulu.
From Honolulu?
Yes.
Oh. How long have you been away from Honolulu?
It's been many years since I was 12 years old.
It's been many years since you were 12 years old? Oh, I don't think so.
Shall I tell you how many years, though?
Well, I don't want to pry into your private life, Mrs. Ludwig. You're a very attractive young girl. I'll keep my mouth shut. And you're married, huh?
Yes, Mr. Marx.
What does your husband do?
He's a driver's license examiner for the motor vehicle department.
Oh. Well, I'll be mighty nice to you. Marjorie Kendall, you were chosen because of your unusual occupation. Now, what sort of work do you do?
I'm a secretary and part-time genealogist.
Oh, I see. Well, what is a genealogist?
One who trace family lineages, family trees.
Now, Margie, how did you become interested in family trees? Were you looking for termites or...
No, I was looking at my own family history.
Uh-huh. I started looking at my family once, but I stopped when I got to Chico. It was frightening. Right? Now, how far did you trace your family?
To 445 A.D.
I'd be satisfied if you could trace me back to 445 A.M.
Ha,
I'm not sure I want to go back there again. Now, Marjorie, why should people want to know their family trees? Isn't that a little snobbish?
Oh, no. It's a curiosity on the part of almost everyone to know what their family name means.
How about the name Marks? Could you look up the family tree?
Oh, I did several years ago with several other Hollywood personalities.
Is that so? Why should you look up my name?
Well, because it was you were an interesting person, and I've always admired you, and you were my favorite comedian.
I've never did anything that any other boy couldn't do. Now, what did you find in my family tree?
Oh, mostly, of course, you have a beautiful crest.
Say, you look pretty good yourself. What do you mean by a beautiful crest?
Well, there's in the crest.
You mean a family crest?
Yes, sir.
Like two horse thieves swinging from a potted palm?
Two wings that were partly crossed and a little bit of gold embellished on them. And
you mean I had wings? Was the crest of the Marx family?
Yes, sir.
You mean my forefathers were fan dancers, eh? Now, Mrs., you're with the unemployment office?
Yes, Mr. Murray.
Uh-huh. Where is that?
I work in the harbor area.
In the water? And what are your duties there?
Well, I attempt to find positions for people who are in need of them.
Could you find a position for me?
Well, very possibly. What kind of work are you interested in?
Why should I be interested in work with the racket I've got? Now, suppose I'm unemployed. You can never tell about sponsors, you know. Of course, the DeSoto Plymouth is different, eh? In a DeSoto, you drive without shifting. You ought to be very happy with me. I'm about as shiftless as they come. Where was I? Oh, yes. What kind of jobs do you have the most calls for?
Well, highly skilled technicians and of course, good secretaries are always hard to get.
Yes, they are, especially for a man of my age. Even fair ones I'm having difficulty with. Now, how is the unemployment situation out your way right now?
As I say, that demand for highly skilled remains prevalent. But the mackerel season is
The mackerel season is on now?
Yes.
Well, how many unemployed mackerel are there? That's as fishy a story as I ever heard. Okay, now let's see if you'll get the chance at the $1,000. Fenneman, explain the rules.
Well, you bet as much of your $20 as you want in each of four questions. And the couple that earns the most money gets a chance at the $1,000 DeSoto Plymouth question at the end of the show.
Okay, here we go. Let's see how high I can build you $20. You've selected personalities of the 20s. Here's your first question. How much will you bet?
$10.
$10, okay. The Bambino was undisputed king of the ballparks during the 20s. What was his name?
Babe Ruth.
Babe Ruth is right.
And you're on your way. You have $30.
Remember, you're going for $1,000 tonight. Now, how much of the $30 will you bet on your second question?
$29,
huh? Okay. Who defeated Jack Dempsey twice, the second time in 1927? He was an ex-Marine.
Gene Tunney.
Gene Tunney is correct.
You're reclimbing now. You have $59.
You're climbing with $59. Here's your third question. How much are you going to go for?
$55.
Okay. The hopalong of the 20s was a straight-shooting cowboy with a horse named Tony. What was the cowboy's name?
Tom Mix.
Tom Mix is correct.
Now you have $114.
$114. And here's your last chance to be the other couples. How much of the $114? All of it? Okay. You're gamblers. What was the name of the colorful revivalist who, during the 20s, drew thousands of people to his meetings?
Billy Sunday
is correct.
And you wind up with $228.
Thank you very much.
Fenneman, just a moment. There's something I want to clear up. Remember last week in the quiz, one question was, what do you call the Australian and New Zealand troops of both world wars? You remember that?
Yeah, I remember the question.
Well, the Austrian war bride and her husband, she said diggers, and I said that was wrong because the official name was Anzacs. Well, a lot of people said diggers was the slang name for him, so we're sending Mr. and Mrs. Schwander $180.
That's very nice.
Fortunately, it wasn't enough to affect the standings for the big question, so thank heaven that remains the same as it turned out on the show. All right, on with it, Fenneman. Who's next?
We invited...